Welcome back to Conflicts of Interest. This is November 12th, 2024, and episode 710 of the show. I am the host today, Kyle Anzalone, and I am joined by my friend, who I have known for some time now, one of the more interesting libertarians that I have met, and just, you know, one of the real unknowns of the libertarian movement. So, Joe Terwilliger. Joe, welcome to the show. Terwilliger. All right. Sorry about that. Welcome to the show. And just take 2 or 3 minutes, introduce myself to you. You introduce yourself to my audience. When I was introduced to you first by Keith Knight at Freedom Fest a few years ago, he came up to me and he said, "Kyle, you're going to love this guy." And basically just sat me and you and down to start talking. And we had a fantastic conversation. So I'll just let you introduce yourself to my audience.
Okay, sure. Hi, I'm Joe Terwilliger. I'm a professor of genetics at Columbia University, which may sound strange for a libertarian, right? But I'm also the campus co-chair for Heterodox Academy and been involved in the Association of Libertarian Educators, the board of that, you know, working with the party as much as I can. But the reason that Kyle, I guess, asked me to come here is because I've had some rather unusual experiences working as a human geneticist. In the United States, we're all extremely mixed. You know, we have a lot of diversity, which it's a good thing, of course, but it's not a good thing when you're trying to find the causes of genes. So we often have to travel around the world to look for more isolated populations, which are often isolated politically, culturally, and geographically. And as a result of that, I end up working in a lot of the places on Earth that most people don't really want to go to that often, at least not Americans. So, like, my longest standing project over the last 30 years has been of a remote community in Venezuela, where we've been doing active research as the government actually collapsed, and we can sort of have data on an ongoing basis. And we're still able to keep this going with funding from the U.S. government, which is good for us because it changes the way they see us as not being dangerous to them. Yeah, as being at least doing something nice. I also have worked in the former Soviet Union, and that started as a result of a project I had working with the Korean diaspora, where we were looking at Koreans raised in different parts of the world. Now, the Cold War and the politics of the 20th century led to Koreans being dispersed more than most populations in a relatively short time. So the genes haven't changed, but the environment has. So I worked in Kazakhstan with ethnic Koreans who were sent there by Stalin in the 1930s. We also looked at Koreans in China, which are near the North Korean border, who until around the year 2000 mostly only had contact with the North Koreans in DPRK. Now it's changed, so they have a lot of interaction with the South Koreans. We also worked with Koreans who were adopted and raised in Sweden. Again, it's like taking plants and growing them in different soil, and you see what happens. As a result of that project, of course, I had to learn to speak Chinese and Russian and Korean. And I met a lot of people in the project that were really interesting and different from what I thought. And among those were North Koreans, because there's a lot of those in Kazakhstan and a lot of those in China. And it just makes the scientist in me really curious to learn more about them. So I did. And I took it upon myself to go over to the country and to try to see it a few times. I went a couple times as a tourist in North Korea. Then there was a call from the American Statistical Association to teach statistics to their government officials. So I signed up for that. I thought, wow, this is a great chance to go there and get to live in the country. Unfortunately, I seemed to be the only one who applied that actually got a visa from the North Koreans. And so they asked me if I would instead teach at this university in Pyongyang, the Pyongyang University of Science and Technology, which is run by foreigners, mostly by Americans of Korean origin, who often came from the North and wanted to go back and try to do something to promote goodwill in North Korea. It's still an ongoing university where they teach business, computer science, and agriculture. And I taught human genetics and evolutionary biology in the agriculture section. But an interesting thing about this university is you get an insight into how the country works and how they're developing. And perhaps the most exciting thing for libertarians might be that almost every student in the university, because we eat with them and live with them on campus 24/7 when we're there, you ask them, what do you want to do when you graduate? And the most common answer I heard is, I want to be a CEO. So, you know, they're learning business, they're learning about these things, they're learning English, they're taught in English there mostly. I can speak Korean, but we're supposed to use English with the students. And we also get to live there and really experience life there. And it's the least libertarian place on Earth, perhaps. And to me, that's what made it interesting. Because I'm also a mathematician. I do statistics and analysis. And in math, you often say, well, what if I'm wrong? Look at the opposite. Assume the opposite and see what happens. And so I had a chance to live there and get to know these people and try to observe like Captain Kirk was supposed to do without interfering in the development of a foreign culture. And I learned quite a bit about them. As a result of this, I also, when I was in North Korea, at one point, they showed the basketball game on TV where Dennis Rodman was there with Vice magazine. And in this incident, the students all came to me and said, wow, we stayed up all night last night watching this game. And we saw this strange looking American guy saying nice things about our country. And it makes us reevaluate our stereotypes because they're all told that we're all trying to kill them and that we're bad and that we're just mean people. And when they actually interact with us, they learn that we're not, that we're just like they are. We're nice people. They're nice people. They have normal lives. You know, they mostly deal with family and everything else, just like everybody in America. And of course, that's where your happiness comes from in life, really, is from your family, your friends, your close circles. And so, you get an understanding of them that they're really nice people. So I come out and I get the chance to, I saw there was a charity auction to play horse with Dennis Rodman. And so I invested $2,500 approximately, and I won the auction. And I got the chance to meet him and basically just talked about Korea and how to go back, but he didn't know how. And he went to a travel agent, and they wouldn't sell him a ticket. And so I said, well, you know, it's okay. I know the embassy staff in New York because I meet with them fairly often, and I can help you out. And so we ended up arranging his return trips, and I got to go along as part of the entourage, helping with arrangements. Well,
I just want to ask a little bit more about the initial horse game and how this all, because this is interesting, right? Where, you know, so I went to college just north of Chicago. I wasn't from the area, but one of the things that a lot of my people who I went to school with, they love Dennis Rodman, big Dennis Rodman people. And to me, he always just seemed like this odd guy. And then, you know, the next time I really saw him was he's on CNN standing there next to Kim Jong-un at a basketball game. And it just seemed like the most unbelievable thing, and was almost just at the time, you know, I'm in college, almost a comical story, right? And it now turns out I meet you and you were a part of all this. And so, look, as a libertarian, we talk a lot and we hope that you know, each administration is going to be less hawkish and we're already against the next war. But rarely do we get to do anything that actually stops the war state. And here you went and spent $2,500 of your own money on a basketball game, or, you know, a horse game with Dennis Rodman. And, you know, you were just took the gamble that this would work out, and it did. So I guess, did you actually play the horse game? You know, did he win? And you know, how'd that all go? Did you guys like hit it off right away? Was he a hard guy to get to know? You know, and then did you have any reservations about going to North Korea like this? Were you concerned at all? Or were you just like, you know, this is what needs to be done?
Well, I'd already been to North Korea several times, so I wasn't worried at all. In fact, when you're
in a spotlight, right? Okay.
Yeah, sure. I mean, the only worry was what America was going to do to us, not what North Korea was going to do to us.
Okay.
And yeah, sure enough, you know, America wasn't exactly kind to Dennis and the basketball players. I mean, but I'm nobody. I'm just the little guy, so nothing affected me because I was just this interesting-looking guy standing behind him in all the pictures, but didn't really say that much. I always kind of kept a low profile. I'm not good at self-promoting, you know. I'm tend to be very sort of work within the system, work with everybody, and try to make shit happen that's going to be good for everyone. So, like with Dennis, we played the horse game. So I invested the money, and then we arranged to meet at Basketball City in New York downtown when he was coming to town the day of the final of Celebrity Apprentice, which Dennis was on. And interestingly, he was on the same team as another friend of mine and of Penn Jillette from Penn and Teller, who was the captain of his team. And he's sometimes libertarian. So I talked to Penn also about what I was doing. He talked to Dennis and put in a good word for me because he and Dennis had a good relationship and all. So that day I get to Basketball City and he comes in with his two agents. And we played horse, and he had with him a reporter from Sports Illustrated, which was hilarious because he was writing about the game. And in the article in Sports Illustrated, he said between Dennis and me, we threw up enough bricks to qualify for membership in the Masons Union. He said something like 157 in 5 minutes. You know, I hadn't played basketball since high school, and while Dennis was never a shooter anyway, so it was pretty comical. But we basically just talked, and I didn't really want to win. Obviously, I didn't expect to, but I kept the game going because I just wanted to keep talking. And his agents and I did most of the talking, and they were really positive about the whole idea, and they didn't know how to go back, and so they wanted my help, and so it was a perfect synergy of our interests.
So talk a little bit about your time in North Korea. How many times have you met Kim? And you've like spoken to him personally. Obviously, you somewhat served as Rodman's translator when the two of them were having a conversation, but you've spoken with him as well, correct?
Yeah, the first time we went, it was in September 2013. And we basically went to North Korea. We didn't know what was going to happen. We met with the sports ministry officials and so forth. They were our official hosts. And they gave us the schedule, which we didn't really believe was going to be real. And then so then the next day they said, okay, schedule's changed. We're getting on a helicopter today to fly to Wonsan to meet the leader at his family compound there. And then we spent a few days there, basically just interacting with him. Rodman was riding horses that Putin had given to his father, and they smoked cigars that Fidel Castro had given to their father. You know, it's all signed. And then Kim didn't like cigars, so he gave the whole box to Dennis, and he smoked them all while we were still in North Korea. It was quite funny. But they got along great. You know, we met his daughter. You know, she was a little baby then, Kim Joo-hae, and his wife and his brother and sister and everybody. And we had all kinds of fun. I mean, I couldn't participate in the jet skiing, but they all went jet skiing with Kim, you know, around in the sea over there. I couldn't, because actually in that summer in late July, I'd gotten a retinal detachment while I was in North Korea teaching at the university. So I ended up going to South Korea to get treated and everything. So I just had surgery, and I couldn't participate in anything athletic, but I missed out on the opportunity to go race jet skis with him, but I got to watch. So it was very friendly.
And then you were back in North Korea at least one more time, correct?
With Dennis.
Well, with Dennis.
A few times. Okay. We went, yeah. That December, we went back to pick teams for a basketball game that Dennis had arranged for January, where we were going to bring a team of NBA All-Stars, which we did. Guys like Doug Christie, Vin Baker, you know, Kenny Anderson, Cliff Robinson, a whole bunch of guys. We had a whole team of NBA players. And we played a game against the North Koreans on Kim Jong-un's birthday. And of course, the reason to have it on Kim Jong-un's birthday is they can't change the date, and they couldn't reschedule or anything like that. So, because they often reschedule things, it's really hard to organize something if you want to bring a team of NBA superstars over there. So we did that in January of that year. And then we went back. I think the biggest.
Well, there was. So I wrote an article about you that's published at the Libertarian Institute, titled "The Man Who Could Help Trump and the or Bring Peace to Korea." And in that article, I think there's one. I think my favorite quote from you is, "What did Kim tell you at that meeting about you guys bringing the NBA players?" And this is why I think your particular, you know, role in all of this is important, because this is Kim's relationship with you and his impression of you.
Right. He said to us that when we brought the team over there, he says, "Wow, I can't believe this happened." He says, "You're the first Americans that ever kept their word." Because we all understand why we don't trust North Korea, right? We all have an idea about that. But they have just as much reason not to trust us. You know, in the armistice for the Korean War, we said no new kinds of weapons in the Korean Peninsula, and then Eisenhower put nukes in South Korea. They were only removed much later. Then, you know, you had Bill Clinton negotiating this deal with the North Koreans to give them light water reactors in exchange for them shutting down the main nuclear reactor, and then Bush slow walked it and killed that deal, right? And then you had, you know, it's just a continuing set of these sort of things where one guy makes a deal, the other one doesn't. Like Obama made the JCPOA, and then Trump backed out of the JCPOA with Iran. You know, and they see all of this, and of course they have reason not to believe anything we say, because one thing Kim Jong-un said to us, he goes, you know, "We're always the same, but every 4 or 8 years you guys change. So if we don't like what's happening, we just wait 4 years." you know.
Yeah, I guess unfortunately though, every 4 years is, well, maybe with Trump as an exception, it's a more intense military posture against North Korea from the American side, especially, you know, during the Biden years that's really happened. But yeah, I thought that was just so important. And one of the things when I was first becoming a libertarian is I heard Ron Paul say a lot, you know, playing sports is so important because this breaks down barriers. And I really always thought that was like kind of overly idealistic. Like, you know, can playing baseball really with the Cubans really make a difference? But this is a real example of, you know, you play going and playing basketball for Kim on his birthday, making a real difference in the North Korean perception of Americans. And, you know, not only do you see that at the upper levels, but you also saw that among, you know, just the people of North Korea, the students. And so I think you have a really unique perspective here that almost no other Americans have of North Korea. You know, how many people know Kim also know a significant number of North Korean students. Most Americans who have traveled to North Korea do so on the tourist visa, right? And so they get the very ushered around, you know, performance that North Korea wants to put on, but I'm assuming they didn't do that for you year after year after year. You were teaching and interacting with the students, and I'm sure, you know, you had some candid conversations with them, and we don't have to get into all that, but, you know, you got to know the North Korean people in a way that I'm guessing there's not many other Americans, certainly, you know, maybe some Korean Americans, but not, you know, white Americans have, you know.
Yeah, very few. And even with the Korean Americans, they're often more restrictive because they're Korean. So it creates an obstacle. You know, they're kind of don't really want people talking to other Koreans who speak Korean. I mean, I speak Korean, but they don't quite know what to do with me. You know, also, especially since I have, you know, since I know Kim Jong-un personally, that also changes things. But I mean, we've been able to turn that trust. Like, I wanted to build the trust with Kim Jong-un so I could do other things. Like, for example, I got their approval to do a student and faculty exchange program between Columbia University, where I teach, and Kim Il-sung University in North Korea. We got funded for it and everything, and it only ended when the travel ban came in on American citizens going to North Korea during 2017, in the middle of the Trump administration, when they were still in this sort of not so friendly phase. And that ban has stayed in effect, of course, to this day, so I haven't been able to go back since then. But we were there in 2017, and, you know, for the most recent visit, and again, it was all love, and we had lots of positive interactions. I even got to the point where with the exchange program with North Korea, the North Koreans, like I also went there with the American Association for the Advancement of Science on several occasions to do sort of science diplomacy things where we're bringing scientists, because much like sports, science, music, academics are all things where you can build relationships without it being overtly political, you know? So like there's been a long going project with Americans doing volcano research together with the North Koreans on their sacred mountain, which is a volcano. So there's a lot of stuff going on there. But when the sanctions came in, the UK, who was the official host of that, made them remove seismometers from North Korea, where they had them all over measuring stuff and collecting data. And of course, after that happened is when they did their nuclear test. I was like, you people don't understand the concept. You leave those in, you don't take out things because they could be dual use or a benefit to them. You know, my God, you know, but this is what always happens. Politics gets in the way of scientific interaction, of cultural interaction, of sports interaction. At one point, they asked me to even arrange, they realized from our course, so we taught them a course on how to write for international scientific journals. We had one of the editors of Science was with us, you know? And she was telling them all this stuff and showing them stuff on our phones about the internet, because they don't have the internet, the scientists there, but we did on our phones in North Korea. So we're showing it on the screen and we're trying to make the point that you've got to have internet to do science, to review papers and all this. And then they came to me in 2018 and said, well, could we send our scientists to China or Russia and have you teach them how to use internet for science, for biology? And I was like, great, excellent. We have this money for this exchange program. We're going to do it. We set up a way to do it. The Chinese were a little scared, but in Russia, they agreed to do it at this Far Eastern Federal University in Vladivostok, where they would host us at their university, which is where Kim and Putin met the first time. And they were going to give us computer facilities and we were going to teach them. And then our government said, one sentence, this is not in the interest of the United States of America. And it's always this obstacle is the State Department to diplomacy, which is the ironic part of it all. You know, I mean, we've done a lot of good things for relations with America and North Korea, and the North Koreans trust me. I mean, I talk to them quite frequently now, even in New York, and no one from our government talks to them because they've lost interest in trying to deal with the Biden administration, because all they say is give up your nukes, give up your nukes, give up your nukes. But they don't want to end up like Gaddafi. You know, I mean, come on, they're not stupid and they're not crazy. And this is
well, that's another thing that Kim said to you, right? And I think I think it's so important, the full quote that I have in the article, because everybody always cites the Saddam and the Gaddafi examples as saying these are people who gave up their nuclear program and then the dictators were ultimately disposed of. And so if Kim wants to stay in power, the newts are Western kryptonite. But there's another example too, and that is Pakistan. And Kim said to you that Pakistan harbored Osama bin Laden, but there was no regime change in Islamabad, right? And so that's as such an important example too, where not only does he have the example of what happens when you give up newts, but he also has the example of what happens when you keep newts. And I guess, I don't know, maybe next time if you ever talk to Kim again, you'll have to talk to him about Imran Khan and how it seems like he was a little bit disposed of by the State Department. At least they signed off on that transfer of power in Islamabad. But generally speaking, there's not going to be the kind of revolution, say, that the Iraqis or the Libyans faced with the funding or the direct warfare of the Americans. And so, you know, those are just such important things that you personally know from Kim. And I'm guessing that, you know, he emphasized and decided to tell them to you because he wants Americans to know that this is the North Korean position, which, again, is one of the, you know, things I think is so important about what we're talking here and, you know, how maybe you could help the Trump administration end the Korean War here is, of all Americans, you're probably maybe one of a handful of people. And I'm guessing that Dennis Rodman isn't going to get any official State Department position that has a somewhat positive relationship with the North Koreans. And look, obviously, you know, it's not that you're wanting to do something great for Kim Jong-un here, but you see an opportunity to help everyone by de-escalating tensions on the Korean Peninsula.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, you know, the problem is that no American president has ever taken first use of nuclear weapons by America off the table in a war with North Korea. And we openly say we want regime change. Every president says this. I mean, what message are they supposed to get? Of course, they don't trust us, right? That's why it's important to have people there who do have a good relationship, like President Trump does, like we do. You know, I mean, we all try to do what we can to get to a better place for world peace, because I have friends in North Korea that I care about. They're actual friends. They're not robots. They're human beings. And I care about them. I don't want them dying. I don't want us dying. I don't want this going on for no purpose. I mean, everybody has the argument you often get from people that work on policy with North Korea is that we have to be really vigilant because North Korea says in their constitution that they want to take South Korea by force. Well, now they changed their constitution and said, North Korea is our enemy. We don't want to reunify. We don't want anything to do with them. And that to me says, okay, now we can do something to build peace because they're not threatening to go south. And the fact of the matter is they never would. It's been obvious for 20 years that they wouldn't invade if South Korea removed their army and said, please walk in and take us over, because they don't want their people listening to South Korean music or watching South Korean movies. They surely don't want them engaging directly with worldly South Koreans. You know what I'm saying? It's like if they surrendered tomorrow and just said, come, take over our country, that would be the end. They know that. They wouldn't do it. And that, to me, is the biggest nonsense of this all.
So let's, I guess, looking at the current situation, I think one can make an argument that it's too late. 2017, Joe, Trump makes you the envoy. We get something done. Look at what happened. I mean, Trump came in, the fire and fury stuff. I do think Trump and Kim were able to put that behind them. It did seem that the direct leader-to-leader communication was absolutely crucial during the first Trump administration. So, look, you know, even if they don't put you in an official position, I'm sure any advice would be Trump, send Kim Jong-un a letter. Don't go through whoever Marco Rubio ends up as the second Secretary of State, you know, take this into your own hands and send Kim a letter, win yourself a Nobel Peace Prize. But there seemed to be some real positive movement. North Korea had engaged in a, 99% moratorium on their missile testing. They had destroyed a missile testing facility. There was some real progress. Yep. Then, of course, John Bolton screwed that up at Hanoi. But Trump rebounds a little bit with the trip to the DMZ. Nothing gets done after. Biden comes into office and... I mean, this goes completely unnoticed. I feel like I was one of the few people really covering this at the Libertarian Institute. I probably have 100 articles on all the different North Korean missile tests and the American war games in response, which were all provocative. But the major provocations, I think, were the increased number of the strategic military assets. So, you know, bombers that could drop nuclear weapons, aircraft carriers, these major weapon systems to South Korea, all in threats to the North Koreans. And then probably even more importantly, Biden's insistence on bringing South Korea and Japan into an alliance. And now in Washington, that's all about Beijing. Yep. But in Pyongyang, it doesn't matter, right? Like that's a direct threat to them. And so I want to ask you one question that you may have the best insight on. And this is, I don't know if you would know this from Kim or from North Koreans. Is the World War II imperial legacy of Japan like very present still with the North Koreans? Is that like a major threat? Like this would be seen as like, you know, kind of reconstitution of the Third Reich or something like that. Or is that not necessarily something that's discussed or present in the culture? And then also, is it just simply too late? Has the Biden administration gone so far? And then included with their blunders in Ukraine, which, you know, they try to isolate Russia from the world, Putin went and met with Kim and signed a deal. So does Kim say, you know, I'm happy, I'm in a good place where I'm at, I'm not going to pick a fight with the Americans, but I have no reasons to make a deal with you at all?
Yeah, I mean, as to Japan, I mean, yeah, they really don't like Japan, you know, they for obvious reasons. But I think North Korea is very pragmatic about these things. They want to deal with everyone. There's been outreach from Japan. They've discussed a summit, right? And they discussed interactions and they've done negotiations. They almost had a deal before, but then it got hung up on some of these, the kidnapping things where Japanese people had been kidnapped to North Korea and, you know, to teach Japanese there. So these became real stumbling blocks with Japan making a deal with them, which, yeah, fine. We all understand that that's a legitimate point. But they would like to make a deal with anybody they can. They know, for example, that Russia is not necessarily going to be there when the Ukraine war is over. You know, they have a bad history with Russia after the fall of the Soviet Union, where they felt abandoned by them. So there's this lingering thing where they question how long that will last and how good that will be. So I think they'd like to deal with us. In fairness to the Biden administration, during COVID, there was nobody going in or out of North Korea. Even their own diplomats couldn't go back to North Korea. So there was no real opening, no real communication at all then. And part of that was because they were hermetically sealed. And they did keep COVID out for more than 2 years, until which time COVID had become significantly weaker and it actually didn't seem to have a huge effect in North Korea when it got there. But for those reasons, they can get a little bit of a break on some of it. But they didn't really try to engage early on when they could have. They didn't keep the momentum going. They, in the later days, they started saying, well, yeah, we'll have talks with no preconditions. But the North Koreans knew that that's not real. They know there's preconditions and they know that. So they kind of lost interest in dealing with America because we have a flaky relationship with them and all this. But earlier this this year, they had an editorial in the newspaper where they said, we understand the importance of personal politics with the relationship between Kim and Trump, although that's not the basis for a long-term solution because America changes its mind every time a new leader comes into power, gets rid of the effects of the previous leader. So while we talked about what we wanted from North Korea was complete, verifiable, irreversible denuclearization, we've never offered anything that's complete, verifiable, and irreversible. And that's what really has to be thought about is if Trump is going to do something in the next term, he's got to come up with something concrete, maybe something small and something simple, but things that are complete, verifiable, and irreversible. And forget about denuclearization for now because they're committed to that. They don't want to cease to exist, right? They're not stupid. And they've seen what we do, and we said we would nuke them in the event of a war. Or we refuse to say we won't. So of course they want, if everybody's got nuclear, if their enemy has nuclear weapons, they want them to prevent, you know, a real problem. Now, for the US, the issue with North Korea is secondary in the thinking to denuclearization in general. So their concern is if they let North Korea off the hook, that's gonna incentivize Iran and other countries to go the same route. Whereas if they see us turning North Korea into a basket case, they won't. So that's not a very humane approach to this problem, but it's one that you kind of, you understand their rationale that this is something they really care about. And so it's an obstacle to get past that if we wanna make a deal from the American side. It's also an obstacle to get past the engagement that North Korea has now in Russia. My assumption is in Russia that if they have troops there, it's only going to be to help Russia throw the invading army out of Russia, because Ukraine invaded that part of Russia where the North Koreans are. So they're if they're involved at all, it'll be on that level, I guess. But that creates a relationship with Russia. And the problem there is that in the past, Russia has always been eager to help promote peace between the U.S. and North Korea through whatever method they could. Now they have an interest in not doing that because we're going to be telling North Korea you have to break up with Russia. You know, so we have to worry about that. And that's why I think we really have to get on this Ukraine war situation first and come to some sort of a deal there, which Trump says he's going to do in a day. I'm not convinced that it'll work that fast, but let's hope for the best on that one. Because once that happens, it opens the possibility for other things. Because we keep telling the Chinese that they have to do more about North Korea, but China is probably the country North Korea hates the most, because China can open and close the sanctions and make them jump. And if you've ever met a Korean, North, South, or whatever, they don't like to be told to jump. You know, that no one wants to be told what to do. Something we as libertarians especially understand well. And so for those reasons, they really would rather not have to deal with China. And China doesn't have much influence over them, other than like, yeah, we can starve you. But now that Russia is providing them, presumably with some sort of sanctions relief, that changes the calculus there as well. So Russia is really a key to this, and building a better relationship with Russia, I think, is going to be critical to finding a solution here.
Yeah. So I guess this is, I think, the hardest question I have for you. Yeah. And, you know, I think one of the obstacles you would face if, you know, this seriously gets the ball moving is there's going to be people in Washington, you know, my guess would be Marco Rubio, Mike Waltz among them, who will say a part of the reason that we can't have a deal with North Korea is because we need reasons to tie China, or not China, South Korea and Japan together. And really, it's not about fighting a war with North Korea, because we never plan to fight a war with North Korea. How could a war with North Korea be fought? You know, it's a country that primarily relies on its nuclear weapons as a deterrent. Mm-hmm. And so it's a war that is quickly going to go nuclear. That's a real problem. And look, so, you know, even if they can't hit the United States of America, Seoul is very close to the border. You know, mm-hmm. Explosion, even if not in Seoul, just, you know, along the coastline of South Korea.
I didn't hear what you said because there was a breakup in the connection.
Oh, I was just saying, due to what's going on in the proximity of North Korea and South Korea, yeah, you know, any kind of war, Seoul is going to face massive barrage, even if not a dread nuclear attack. Yeah. And so it seems unthinkable, but we have to have all the, you know, our Asia Pacific strategy relies upon everybody in the region being united against China. And so do you have a counter argument to that? Is it just that we can't be this cynical? We had to get along with the North Koreans? Or, I mean, is there an argument that says if we don't have to worry about North Korea, you know, in North Korea, as you say, isn't that friendly with China anyways, then maybe this is kind of stripping away ally from, so what's your take on this?
Well, I mean, as you very well know, we've spent much of the last 4 years, especially in the Biden administration, but it started under Trump, tightening this ring of alliances around Russia, Iran, North Korea, and China. None of those countries like each other. None of them want to deal with each other, but we force them to deal with each other. And as we tighten these nooses around them, we make it even more tight of a relationship among those four countries. Because I mean, to me, it was the funniest thing that happened in the Biden administration was when North Korea was accused of selling ammunition, weapons to the Russians. We complained to the Russia that that violated sanctions on North Korea. And then we complained to the North Koreans that it violated sanctions on Russia. And I'm like, what are you people thinking? I mean, it's like, if you tell the different countries you can't eat and you can't eat, they're not just going to starve. They're going to trade with each other so they can eat. So a lot of the problem we have with this alliance tightening of our own is that we're building up these other alliances and we're creating this problem between these countries. And we're making North Korea maybe get along better with China and Iran to get along with North Korea. I mean, they have nothing in common, but now they're talking, right? They have nothing in common between Iran and Russia, really, other than that we have they have the same enemy that's trying to destroy them. So by building this really tight noose around them, we're actually increasing, in my mind, the probability of a major conflict. You know, you can tolerate minor conflicts, but this major conflict that they're pushing towards is really dangerous, right?
Yeah, and it's unbelievable. The neocon like fantasy evil is, you know, now a self-fulfilling prophecy where these countries that, again, shouldn't have any relationship with each other have all been forced together. The Iranians and the Venezuelans are trading. You know, in all the, in again, you know, Brits is now 50% of the world population, I believe, like a third of the world economy. Oh, okay. The Shanghai Cooperation Organization, also massive. The trade between Russia and China going up. And again, these are all countries that naturally, I think, have, if anything, animosity or at least unease in dealing with each other. And that, you know, we've just given them such a big enemy. And so, you know, I think this may be one of the last real chances, this Trump administration, to unwind these before the, you know, historical ties and everything from what they're going to see as overthrowing the Washington-led world empire may start to overcome the anxieties between China and Russia in Russia's eastern region or whatever kind of issues the North Koreans have with Beijing. They may say, you know, what we were able to accomplish there shows what benefits getting together has. And, you know, we're just, you know, have no longer but the Washington world empire. And I don't know, that seems like a real time that Washington should really start acting here before this all kind of unwinds in that way.
No, absolutely. I mean, the concern in Washington isn't really about the Chinese military threat. I mean, you know, China has one base in Djibouti and they're discussing possibly one in Equatorial Guinea, right? This is the extent of their massive empire, right? Meanwhile, we have our troops are everywhere. I mean, we fly aircraft carriers. We float them right off the Chinese, you know, the limit of their territorial waters all the time. They're not exactly floating aircraft carriers through the Gulf of Mexico, you know, I mean, threatening us directly. So the problem is that we have this situation where we're more concerned about China's economic competition with us, right? And right now their economy is smaller than ours, right? But they have four times the population. So that means they're four times poorer than we are. And we want to maintain this sort of dominance, which doesn't seem to me that that's in the interest of America, because we'd also like to have the market, right? We'd like everyone to prosper. That's what we believe, at least as libertarians. But meanwhile, China, since like the last 25 years or so, they've been investing heavily in the Middle East, in Africa, in Latin America, even in the Balkans. It's like, I remember going to Kosovo in like the early 2000s, and there's Chinese stores everywhere. I went to Iraq, to Erbil in Kurdistan in 2011, and they had a Chinatown, right? Every airline I took in the Middle East had a Chinese-speaking flight attendant because there were so many of these countryside Chinese people doing business there who couldn't speak a word of English. It was only Chinese, but they were going abroad to make money. And they invested like this all over the world, and we didn't. Because it's one thing you can do more easily, I guess, in a totalitarian country is tell people you should go there, you're going there, you're going there, and here's your opportunities. We haven't done that. So we're not competing in the developing world, in the global South. We aren't competing effectively in Africa, in Latin America, as well as South Asia. And for these reasons, of course, there, you know, China's been investing. And so there's a lot of Chinese potential in developing these things that they've talked about with Belt and Road Initiative and all these other things they've done to try to expand their power. But their power that they want to expand is not military, it's economic, right? And then you've got Africa, who listens to the French talking about the war with Russia, how Russia is bad. And in Africa, they're just saying, well, Russia never tried to colonize us. France did. So maybe we don't go with France. You know, so this is part of the reason why Russia's getting influence in all these other places as well, in China. And they're seen as benevolent, where we used to be seen as the good guys by people across the world that wanted hope for the future. They're now seeing it as being, well, China is helping us develop. Russia is, you know, willing to talk to us. And America's, you know, being a bit different about this. So right. We have problems that we've created.
Yeah. And I mean, I would just say I've heard a lot of statements from Africa, which isn't necessarily that they think China is the good guy, the white hat, just that they're going to cut you a better deal than the Americans. Well, I remember there's one quote where somebody said, well, if you make a deal with the IMF, they'll just steal everything. If you make a deal with China, at least they'll build the hospitals first.
Right.
And so it's not that they don't think they're going to get stitched by the Chinese and overpay for everything, but the hospitals, the ports, et cetera, would actually be built rather than what would happen with the IMF. So, Joe, anyways, this has been a fantastic conversation. I definitely want to have you back on the show. Sure. And maybe we could like talk some more current events and things like that. Yeah. It's been, because I know you got thoughts on a lot of things other than North Korea. But anyways, I think there's a real opportunity here with the Trump administration, with your previous ties and your relationship with Kim, to make this happen and to potentially, you know, at least again, we could ratchet down the tensions with the North Koreans. It's been going in the wrong way for decades. Yep. And, you know, eventually, even though it seems war is unthinkable, you do run out of, you know, kicking the can down the road and the North Koreans watching the Americans build up military alliance and their military presence in the region and continue with the provocations. And, yep. You know, we could really de-escalate here. You may be the man to do it. So, Joe, thank you so much for joining us. Any final thoughts? And then we'll wrap up.
Yeah, no, basically, I appreciate your invitation to be on your show. I'm always happy to talk about these things if anyone wants to listen. You know, that's always what I worry about, because there's so many people. The big problem with North Korea scholarship in D.C. is that most of the people that are talking about it and writing about it have probably only been there on a fishbowl tour, if at all. They may not even speak Korean, or if they do, they don't pay attention to the North Korean sources. They don't have the experience in dealing with them. And they're reading books written by other people that hadn't been there and hadn't written about it. So this sort of vision of the country gets, you know, exaggerated in everybody's ideas. I mean, the first time I went there, I'd read everything I could read about North Korea from all these different sources. And when I got there, I'm like, wait, this doesn't make sense. This doesn't compute, you know, because the people there are so innocent and so kind. They're like, hi. And, you know, because they don't have personal responsibility over much things in life, you know, without freedom has a price, right? You have to take responsibility for yourself. And that's what we want as libertarians. But a lot of people don't want that, because if somebody else takes care of them and says, here's your house, here's your car, here's your, you know, your job and everything, they don't have to make any choices and they have no personal responsibility. So they retain this sort of innocence we all had as kids. And it's the analogy I always make, if you think about it, is that you and I, as libertarians, we're the people that when we became 18, we wanted to get out of mom's house, even though we love mom, but we wanted to live under our own rules, right? We wanted to be independent. That's what libertarians are. But then you got people today, a lot of them, who stay in their mom's basement till they're 50, you know, living under my house, my rules, but they're like, that's fine. As long as I don't have to pay rent, it can be your house and I'll do whatever you say. And I start wondering how many of us are like that, especially as the generations move on. Are we becoming more like that than we are like the independent, free-spirited people that founded this country? And the problem is that too many of us think that way, and that may create problems for us. So right. That's sort of my analogy of North Korea versus the world.
All right, Joe. Well, again, thank you so much for joining, and we will have to do this again soon.
Sure. My pleasure.